So hello everyone, welcome to the 3N Dish Podcast, Music and General Crack.
Number two.
I'm Q.
I'm Andy.
And
today, it's good to have you here. And
Yes. Today we're going to be talking about music from the year 1991.
Hi.
What do you think, Andy?
It wasn't a wild pile to choose from, but then whenever you start looking at it, you know what? There's some bangers in it.
There was definitely some very big albums came out that year.
If you stay away from the charts.
If you stay away from the charts, it was...
It's actually pretty good.
Yeah, it was dead on. We'll talk about some notable albums later on, but I think we'll talk about what we did last week, Anthony, I think.
Yeah.
Last week we did, what was it, Christmas music?
We did the Christmas music.
Well, then last week it was a fortnight ago. We did Christmas music and I quite enjoyed it.
It was a lot of fun.
It was the season.
It was the season to be merry.
So, that was dead on last week. We were a bit ropey last week now, I have to say.
We didn't really know what we were doing.
No,
sure.
We don't know what we're doing today either.
No, that's true.
Really.
But, I'm more nervous about this one than the last week.
That would be grand.
But that's fine.
We have different stuff to talk about this year. Or this time. 1991, I know it. So, what can you tell me? What happened in 1991, Anthony?
I'll tell you one thing.
Anything exciting?
Silence of the Lambs was released.
Good film.
That was exciting.
Some TV there recently.
That's an absolute show.
Cracking film. There's a couple of good films. Home Alone was out that year.
Home Alone as well, aye. Commitments.
The Commitments, that's cracking film.
That's unreal.
Good music film.
Best music film.
Good music film. And Terminator 2 also came out that year.
Oh, that's good one too.
A good enough soundtrack for it too. Yeah. Good soundtrack. Guns N' Roses on there.
You can't really go wrong with early Guns N' Roses.
They're pretty good. Pretty good now. And that,
before they fell out amongst each other.
That's right. One of them left. I think one of them did leave that year, possibly. Or not that long after 1981.
Was it the bass player?
I can't remember. No, it wasn't him. No, I can't remember. I read the name and Wikipedia, but I can't really mind it. Two good albums came out that year from Guns N' Roses. Use Your Illusion 1 and 2.
Seen that.
Came out simultaneously. The reason, I don't know.
Which one was the better one?
I think 1 was possibly the better one. I can't remember the track list, but we're going to talk about one of them later on. There's a couple of good ones in the second one as well. I think they were sort of more ballady in the second one. I think.
So that's getting into November Rain territory, I suppose.
I think November Rain was actually number one, but more of the more rockier songs were in number one as well. I think Living Let Die was in the second one.
That's a good song too.
That's a good song. It's been covered quite a bit too, that song.
That is a Beatles song.
Is it? Mm-hmm. Alright. Well, and,
for future reference, we are not doing the Beatles.
No, we're not just that into the Beatles.
I think Beatles are over exaggerated, over...
They were very ahead of their time. They knew how to write catchy stuff.
Yes.
Short, catchy songs that grabbed the people.
They were ahead of their time, but at the same time, it wasn't a good time.
There was all good music out that time, but because the Beatles were so big, it didn't get the same recognition it probably could have got if it came out maybe before the Beatles or after the Beatles or whatever.
That's a debate.
We might touch on that another day. Not today.
No, we're trying to keep it smooth and
we'll try our
going.
Best. Other notable stuff in 1981, aren't they? A lot of famous people died more so than were born.
Yeah.
I know Freddie Mercury was
probably the biggest name on
the
list.
The biggest name. He's always top of the list there. When I was doing my research, he was top of the list every time. A few other notables: Dr. Seuss, beloved writer.
Childhood hero.
Childhood hero, yes, he wrote some class books. Queen Eggs and Ham. And the turtle, you know, you ever read one with the turtles?
No.
The one turtle's trying to be the highest in the pond, so he stacks all the rest of the turtles up and climbs top of them. Then they all fall. before the end.
Was the Grinch a Doctor Seuss thing?
I think he was.
I think that too.
I'm pretty sure he was. Captain Hat.
Captain Hat.
There you go. Miles Davis. If you don't know who Miles Davis is, he's a jazz trumpeter. I'll play a bit of Miles Davis.
Yeah,
he's pretty good now. He definitely played before. Look at this.
Smooth.
It's nice smooth jazz.
Smooth.
The next one's even more jazzy. Let me hear this one. You can just hear that standing in the elevator. Just hear that. It's class.
It's like if you've ever seen Whiplash.
Yes. 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 Yes, that's class.
That is a good film.
That's a good film. What year came out?
2015, was it? And it's on and around that. It was before La La Land. La La Land was awful, so...
Didn't see it.
Not me either. I just knew it was awful.
But that's like... A lot of his music, yeah, Miles Davis stuff, that's all that territory there.
Mm-hmm.
I picked the two jazzy ones. There's some slower ones in there too, but I quite like these ones. Like, listen to that. You listen to that all day.
Background music.
That's exactly what it is. I'm not going to stop at any of those, because we're going to move on. Another notable death, Leo Fender. You can guess who he was.
Guitar maker.
Died 1991. And the last one I have here was Tennessee Ernie Ford.
Hmm.
You probably don't know who that
is. I don't know who that guy is.
Well, I'm going to play a song. If you don't recognize the song, I don't know.
Some
class is a country song.
Say a man is made out of mud. A poor man's made out of mud.
That's more like jazz.
Well, it's...
Muscle and blood.
It's Ernie Elvis sort of...
A mine that's
country.
I can't remember
thing.
The year. I can't remember the year, but
16 tons. What do you get?
Another it's not country.
But it's groovy.
It is. Here's another one. This one slightly more country because the ragtime sort of piano. The shotgun boogie.
That feels more like J.D. Lewis.
It does, yeah.
Jumping in the grass. Wait till they hear my old shotgun.
Boom, 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 boom.
The shotgun boogie.
I done saw your track.
That's a good song. So that's Tennessee Ernie Ford. And that's the notable death. Notable births, so wasn't that many notice.
Pixie Lott was only notable. One that I was notable of.
Well, Ed Sheeran was born that year. Jamie Lynn Spears, Britney Spears' sister, she did record some music.
Mm-hmm. Allegedly.
Allegedly. More importantly, I was born in 1981. In that class. So
people
means,
know your age now. It's...
They don't know me. They don't know when my birthday is. I'm not going to tell you there. More importantly, it's your birthday at least 3 times this year, haven't they?
This month.
That's it. You only had one birthday. You had 2 birthdays last year. We played you on New Year's Day.
And then I had my real one.
Your real birthday. That was funny. But no, you only got 2 years older last year. That's class. Anything else happened to anyone?
Well, if you're into your sport, the only thing worth notable would be the Super Bowl. Giants, New York Giants take on the Buffalo Bills.
That's right.
And beat them in
it was
the
tight.
Super Bowl.
It was tight.
What was the score?
20 points to 19. 1 point an hour.
That's tight.
That was surely. Hubble Space Telescope launched 1991. Still working away there today.
Still going rightly.
Taking good pictures of
things.
The universe. Actually, they are pretty good then. I have a couple of books there. Hubble Space Telescope. Pretty good now.
First website was created that year.
Oh. Anything good?
I think it was just information about the website. This is the internet.
This is a website.
Welcome to the internet.
You can read it. You can read stuff on it. Very good. That's most of the normal stuff. That's all we've really covered on.
The major one was the Soviet Union ending, but that's...
That's a big topic.
That's sad.
It is.
Then,
is it?
They had a long go at it.
They had a good run.
All empires must come to an end eventually. Like the Roman Empire.
Roman Empire. The Greeks and Empire. They were a civilization.
And
didn't they come to an end, but that
the Ottomans.
Era, Incas.
And the British Empire.
But careful out. Careful out.
Whoops, sorry.
Slip of the tongue, mate. But no, that's that.
That's pretty much all that happened in 1881. That was kind of...
Pretty much. We've a couple of our wee bits there we'll touch on later on, but for now, I think we'll jump in to our picks for our songs 1981.
Yeah, we didn't want to go with your bog standard chart songs.
So no, we didn't pick them off, straight off the charts now, I have to say. My selection is definitely not chart toppers.
Mine is kind of on the fringe.
Yes, one of mine is. The rest of them aren't really. But we'll start with you. We've got to head up now. You can go first this day.
We'll start with Sam. We both can listen to George Michael.
George Michael.
You can't go wrong.
Is that George Michael on Elton John?
It is Elton John.
That's right.
It's the live version of this.
That's the one you sent me.
It did. Recorded in Wembley Arena. But yeah, you can't really go wrong with Elton John and George Michael.
So we'll stick her on here now. So there's a live version.
There's a live version.
You're right. Is it as 80s as Wham? Christmas song.
It's not that 80s.
Suppose it came out in the 90s.
It came out in the 90s and it's a 70s song.
There you go.
So
that's cheating, aren't they? All my songs actually came out in 1991.
This did come out in 1991.
The live one. But the song itself isn't it?
But it was an Elton John song first. Mm. And this here version was George Michael's interpretation of it.
Well, listen to Daniels.
You,
it's on now.
You're wrong. Something for the fact that George Michael is the man.
Right.
This will turn into the George Michael podcast. It will.
Well, tell me about the song, Anthony. I know it was playing there in the background.
Well, what have I got here? As I said, it was an Elton John cover song. And this is the live version recorded in Wembley Arena. Mm-hmm. And really, I've only chose this here for the sample of the production value at the very end of the song. Where it is just... You ever seen Bridesmaids?
I have seen Bridesmaids,
you know,
yeah.
The bit where the two of them are trying to do speeches together and they're shouting at each other. And
back and forward.
It ends up like that there. Between Elton and George Michael at the very, very end. It's great. They're like, oh, I'm gonna one up you.
It's very, very petty, that. So it is.
But it does take a wee while to get started, but it is. There's a lot of stuff goes on whenever Elton, surprise, comes out from.
Oh, he shouldn't. Well, he's not supposed to be there. As a technical, he's a special
it's
guest.
It's George Michael's concert.
See.
But yeah. It's like, oh, Elton John's just landed.
It's a power ballad.
It is hard to be a power ballad. We're on the fringe there between 80s disco music. And 90s alternative dark indie vibe, which comes out about 1992, end of 91, 92.
Slap bang, that's right there.
Slap bang, so I thought, we'll start lightly.
Because
we've got now 10 years of depressing and dark. And
I stressed the 90s.
So, here we go now.
We're flying now.
There's a lot of wee jingly things happens in the background too. If you're listening in headphones or earphones, there is wee jingly.
Yes, hard to pick up on a phone speaker or something.
Probably not, unless like the engineer is a master.
And he only listens to his phone. Like them wee bass guitar there. Don't discard me.
Yeah, basically we could just But this is just a bridesmaid. Bridesmaid basically stole this song and put it into words, dialogue.
She hitting over the cellar now. I like that.
Nice driving piano. It's like a rap battle.
Eminem. 8 Mile. George Michael and
Elton John. MC Elton. That's the reason I picked this song, just so they were just bouncing off each other.
That's a pretty good song now.
And then there's a dynamic shift here now, it all drops, and the crowd think it's over, but it's not.
Yes, I've heard them before. George Michael fill in for Freddie Mercury after he died?
You know, I don't know that.
I think he might have. I think they did a couple of live shows with George Michael.
I didn't think they had George Michael. I thought they had that boy from America's Got Talent in the later years.
Randy Jackson. I don't know. No, I wasn't Randy Jackson.
Is that his name?
Who?
Surname's Lambert, I think. Adam Lambert.
They could have actually. That rings a bell. I don't know. I think they do. Maybe possibly do a live show with George Michael on there. But I can't remember.
He might have done.
I'll look that up when I'm in later on.
It probably makes sense. About 91, 92, I suppose. Their Queen's trying to Queen remastered all their.
That's right.
Their old discography.
That's right.
And Freddie died, of course.
It was all popular, I suppose. There was demand for a live show or whatever, maybe.
And plus, Brian May had an album out that year, too.
Did he?
Mm-hmm. A solo album.
Didn't know that.
So, they were all milking it that year.
Well.
And still milking it.
Are they?
I'm not going to lie. I'm not a Queen fan.
I like Queen. We used to listen to it in the car all the time. We always had the tape. I don't listen to that much. I like a couple of songs. I like Crazy Little Thing Called Love.
Crazy Little Thing Called
Love. Bohemian Rhapsody's still a class song.
Debatable.
It's pretty good though.
I think I don't like it because it's popular.
Something for you.
I know. I don't like popular music. It's this.
You're just a fierce curse, yeah. We'll put on.
What's your choice,
Crazy Little Thing Called Love, seeing as you don't like Bohemian Rhapsody.
Oh, that's fine.
This isn't my choice, it's just because we're talking about it.
It's just filler.
Because we're talking about it. That's not bass.
See, that sounds. It doesn't have that Queen sound, you know. I think that's probably why that's their best song.
Maybe. I like it.
We start getting into territory like, we are the champions. Oh, really?
No, I'm not dying about a song.
And we'll rock you. Ugh. And what do you call the one we did karaoke at school?
Karaoke school? I don't know what I'm talking about. Oh, cheers. Don't Stop Me Now.
Don't Stop Me Now.
I like that. I actually like that song.
That is a good song.
I'm listening. It's good while low.
I think it's a bit after the piano intro. It's like,
yes.
Driving guitars.
Aye, and don't Stop Me Now.
Mm-hmm. I think because this sounds like a country song, I think that's why.
Maybe a wee bit.
It's that twangy guitar thing.
Yeah, maybe. It actually probably is my favourite Queen song.
It's the groovy thing.
Yeah.
Ian, everything goes back to Elvis.
That's it. Brian May is a good guitar player though. Still is a good guitar player.
We'll give him that.
I like this part here.
Breakdown?
Yeah.
pure echo. It's Freddy Echo. He's singing in the bathroom.
I like the backup singing there too. Pretty good. Bass guitar is probably the best thing with this song.
Yeah, it is. It's plucky.
It is. It's upbeat. We're not reviewing this song, by the way. We're just...
No, we're just... It's 1981 as well. It's not really, but...
No. It was probably remastered in 1981.
Oh, it definitely was. No doubt about that.
This particular one was remastered 2011.
Again. You know why that is? Royalties.
They'll find out they're going to run out.
Recorded music only has a lifespan of 50 years. So whenever an artist remasters it, it gets another 50 years added onto it because it's a new production.
Yes.
So
very good.
There's your loophole if you're ever a musician.
Any musicians that want their music remastered, contact Elsie.
I will do it.
There we go. So that was... What was your song again? George Michael.
George Michael, Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me.
Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me.
Elton John cover song.
Very good.
With Elton. And then, David Wembley.
Yeah.
Tune.
And then Queen on top of that, so that's pretty good.
Okay, you may as well do your choice now.
Well, I'm going to start. I'm going to go away.
Where are you going to go away?
Across the water. But a Dolly Parton, aren't they?
Ooh.
Now, when I told you this song in, what do you call it, rehearsal? In rehearsal?
Pre-production,
about 10 minutes before we started recording. I told Anthony the song. He's never actually heard this song or heard of it. The song is "Eagle When She Flies," and it was on the album titled "Eagle When She Flies," track number 5. She's been there. Hard to beat Dolly.
You know, you're right. Dolly is
hard to beat. Dolly.
She's a real show woman.
She is, surely. This track. As a single, didn't do so well. It only got number 9 in Canada and number 33 on the US country billboards.
That's quite low.
Not powerful. I suppose it's late Dolly. She was coming around the 60s, wasn't she?
No,
or
she's really 70s, not there.
70s,
late
or 80s.
70s.
Oh, well. It's a bit later Dolly. She had up until that time she had... Like, this was her 31st studio album.
Whew.
Like, you know.
So she's at least 31 years on the road, aren't I?
Yeah, at least. But, I quite like this one. It's like an arm. Or a ballad sort of thing. Piano.
Conway
guitar.
Twig.
You hear a steel guitar in there. In country. There's also a bit of orchestra or something as well. Or
probably later on.
Later on, it definitely is. She's a
lover. Can't throw all your eggs in one basket for second verse. And she's a wife, and she's a spare. Nice build up there.
There's a lot of nice build ups in this, actually. But she's an eagle. There's a bit of orchestra coming now. You can hear them playing in the background. Gentle. Got a backup singer. Strong as steel, her faith and pride. She's an
everlasting shoulder. She's the lead. You didn't watch the Dolly Parton concert on TG Car over Christmas?
No, I didn't know what was on. I didn't watch any TV over the. I watched Chic on New Year's Day. That's about it.
TG Car was something, just the best TV channel this year with all the concerts. And
there are some channels now, TG Car now, to be fair to them. But I don't speak Irish well, or else
we're
at the channel. Here's a bit more build up. This come to end now.
Sounds like a hymn.
Wee bit. Those of them country singers are sort of tied up.
They're all gospel singers.
Gospel.
That's how they all start.
Most of them actually
do start. Johnny Cash and even Elvis.
That's right.
But then Sam Phillips, that's all he did. He did country gospel songs.
Yeah.
Legend.
Yes, that's Dolly.
Lovely. That's a good song.
I like Dolly. Dolly's good.
A lot of wee build-ups there. It's very, very nice.
This, aye.
Nice orchestral section in it. The bit where she jumps up an octave's great.
Yes. That is good. She's pretty good. She has quite a high voice, I know, Dolly. Mm. Did you ever see the video of her singing in Potty O'Shea's bar down in on Gaeltacht?
No, I've never seen
or
that.
Wherever
no.
He's from down there, down County Kerry. I think she's over in the top of Ireland or whatever it was, and she lands down. And she's not really there to sing or anything, she's just there for a holiday or whatever. Mm-hmm. Maybe she's turned there
and
or something.
And it just happened that the cameras were on her.
And the cameras were there.
Of course.
And who was playing? Seamus Begley and Steve Cooney and them were playing. I know it's like they had gear all set up, mics and stands.
Of course.
All set up. I think they knew she was coming, I know. Like,
so obviously they're going to get the top musicians in the country.
They put a big night on for her, I know. And Paddy O'Shea gave her one of his All-Ireland one jerseys and all. Next thing, Steve Cooney's over and says, "Oh, just sure, would you sing one there? I know one of your songs." That was the coat. What do you call the one? Oh, no.
Coat of Many Colours.
Coat of Many Colours. That's what it was. And so it was pretty good. The crowd, as you'd expect, proper Irish crowd, all standing with their arms folded, big grins in their faces.
Big sour faces.
Exactly. But they were loving it. And she was up there smiling away and.
Well, you know they're loving it if they start tapping their foot, so...
Probably, but you couldn't see their feet.
No, but...
They were all standing. But they seemed to enjoy it, because they were big clapping all after. So, maybe I just didn't make a plate. Although, I did it.
No, probably not.
Probably didn't do
you're
it.
In Kerry, so...
Well. It was good. I quite enjoyed it, because she's tapping away. And she doesn't, I don't think she knows what anybody's saying.
No,
down there, like the brave folks, like
accents. Don't even know what they're saying, so.
No, and she's enjoying herself all right. So I quite like it. Most of the video is just her talking to people, and then she sings a song, and that's it. She's talking to people later and after. But it's good. It's good. So that's that. That's my first choice, don't.
All right. I'll go with my second choice. Blur.
Blur. What song is it?
There's No Other Way. Off their very first album.
Just did I even put that in? I should have, because you sent it to me. Yes, I did.
Come on.
He's playing now.
We're getting into. We're just starting up Britpop music.
That's what sounds like
era
now,
so we're. It's a wee bit before the Britpop thing kicked off. It's more Manchester, so it's all funky grooves and jazzy and percussion and.
Yes, I hear the percussion sticking out there, like, so it's on me, you know. Very good.
Yeah, so what was I going to say with this one? Alright, so. It is. Well, we'll get to that bit at the very end. Calm yourself.
You love the very end, so
I love end stuff and I love breakdowns and stuff. There's after this course, there's a lot of out of tuney stuff going on, so it's a wee bit like Pixies. So
yes.
They're all kind of battling for space.
I know.
That guitar, a wee touch, it's just maybe half a note behind. It's actually works really, really well. And then you're talking all the drop ins and drop outs, so it is, it's like a Nirvana or a Pixies song. It is just nice and low and then big
yes,
build up.
Yes.
But yeah, that's, there's nothing. We're just going for nice, easy going music just to.
I'm not an extreme on it.
Not an extreme.
Aye. Fair enough.
I think there's a. Hold on, there is something coming up here now. I thought there was a solo in this. Maybe not.
Maybe they have four bar bridge, isn't it?
Yeah. I didn't do a pile of research, as you know. I just want to. Ah, there we go now. Yeah, that's badly out of tune. It was great.
Like less than until
it's like
no, I'm not going to go there.
Go on,
I'm not going to mention names there, but I'm not going to mention names.
Oh.
That's not what we're here for.
What was I thinking? It sounded like a theremin.
Wee bit.
This bit here coming up now, there he drops her down, and then. How long did it? Yeah, extended outro here.
That's what it is, there's like a whole lot of 40 seconds left.
Yep. The best bit comes out after this here bit. What did I call it? It's like an electronic song, it's like pure. That bit.
That bit here.
You're really starting to sound more like Blur that time. 1983 Blur, so you're going into park life and girls who like boys and you know that song.
Yes, I do know that song.
Yeah.
That's Blur, yeah, that's very good.
You can't really go wrong with Blur. You used to be a big Oasis fan, and then Oasis just stuck to the four chords the whole time and the whole every song, so you knew what it was going to do.
Do you remember the episode Fat Head?
Is that Radiohead?
No, it's the one with Steal the Whistle. I mean that one. I was hanging out with Fat.
The Oasis are a blur.
Aye. We before. Always a blur. I can't remember what it was. First one, he says. He says
blur.
One.
He says
aye.
Blur first.
He says blur.
I mean Oasis.
Aye, that's a good one too.
That is it.
Just Fat. I mean Fat Ted. Was that during that team?
94?
95. I was writing that team, I know it.
Yeah, Britpop is just, you're smack bang in the middle of it. So, and I suppose 1994 would have been Blur versus Oasis.
Yes.
Oasis won originally, but Blur.
Blur took over at one stage or another.
Blur's just way better.
There you go.
So, highly recommend just listen to Blur.
So that's your second choice, aren't they?
That's my second choice.
Very good.
What's your second choice, Keith?
My second choice, I'm going to go. That's not a power ball, what it's called.
Oh.
Guns N' Roses. This is November Rain now.
There's 9 minutes of this? Or did you go for the video edit?
No, I didn't. I went 8:56 of this. But it could have been far worse than that because the original, like the proper original first draft of it was 25 minutes.
Oh.
And they cut it to 9 minutes.
what do you do for 25 minutes?
I don't know.
In a power ball?
Axl Rose wrote the song.
Of course he did.
It came out on that
Illusion.
Use Your Illusion 1, 1981. Let's see, it was 25 minutes originally, cut down to 8:56. Was very popular in a few places. So it was. It was number one in Poland, Portugal, Australia and New Zealand. It was number three in Ireland, US and Ireland. Number four in the UK. And was top 10 in 5 other countries. I can't remember what they were. I don't know the name. Was double platinum Australia actually. Very good. 2 million. Is that just 2 million I take it? Millions of platinum.
Depends on the country.
Yeah. We'll say 2 million.
I think 500,000 is platinum in Australia.
Oh, is it? Well, one double platinum and it was in Australia. Went platinum in UK, New Zealand and Italy. So there you go. I don't know what numbers I had to sell to get that, but I guess 1 million in the UK, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you'll get 1 million at least in the UK.
Depends on your market, how many music listeners. And
yeah, I suppose.
Like you're thinking population of Australia is like 20 million.
I don't even know.
Say 20 million.
Whatever it is.
Population of the UK is...
I brave that more than that.
About 50 million.
50, 60, something like that. Well, there you go. So we'll crack into another say text. Nearly 9 months.
Yep, so we'll just keep it up.
We'll get rattled into her. Starts off slow.
Out of tune, get piano.
A bum note, right at the start. Didn't want to take it a yet.
He's just right, just didn't want to pay extra for it. that's an ordinary amount you have to start.
That's it. But it's nice, this song, more so than any of the rest of their power ballad sort of song, there's like a full orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
If you've ever seen the video, he is on stage playing with a full orchestra. And you can hear the orchestra already. Find the back up there. Takes a while to build into it. It is quite slow until sort of the big solos.
Wow!
It's Slash's solo in November 8 is, that's the longest solo. I didn't write this down. It's what, the longest solo of the 90s or something. I can't remember. It's very long.
I suppose it would have. Yeah. Freebird. That's kind of held the record for a long time.
Is that a solo or is it an instrumental? That whole big bit.
I would call it a solo.
So here we go, we're slipped onto the vocals. Bit of picking guitar. Still have the ruggers to play in the background. A bit of backup vocals. We're getting ready to pick up the drums too. They pick up here shortly. You hear the guitar picking in the back too.
I'm not even hearing the guitar, I'm hearing the orchestra.
Yeah,
the
orchestra is the main thing.
Yeah.
And drum. And the, well, I can't really hear the piano anymore. There's a bit of, I don't know, that.
Something stuff going on.
Yes, yes.
There's like a synth organ at the start of her.
Aye, that's what I hear, right.
Wow. I like the bit in the string section where it's like a double. Do, do, yeah. Do. Do, do. Which is coming up soon. Oh, I just remembered a bit.
Song.
It's a good song.
So this, I know this is a bit of a, I don't know, what do you call this? I wrote interlude minutes, I don't think that's not the appropriate word.
It's not a pre-chorus. It's a
no, there's no chorus in it really. But it goes down, I know, and it builds back up here with the 20 seconds into the solo. We'll be here shortly, this is where we're sort of make toward the rock and roll
now.
You get the strong electric guitar there, and it slides down.
How many guitarists was in Guns Roses 2?
There was.
Rhythm and lead?
There was. But I think the rhythm guitar player leaves. And I think that's just Slash. Does Axl Rose play the guitar as well?
He does.
Well, he probably done the rhythm guitar. There's your first bit of the solo.
So he was more of an acoustic player than an electric player.
He must have been classically trained because he plays the piano on this as well.
Aye.
You can hear the piano playing in the background here too. It's nice. Solo. It's not him too outrageous. Fits the song nicely.
No. But he gets out of hand at the end.
Probably a wee bit. So it's a bit of a break in it. Like, he does come back in for a bit as well.
Definitely standout part of the song is the drums. Nice and easy drums. And then nice wee fillers.
It's not even my favourite bit of the drums. It's a nice bit where he does like marching back drums toward the end. Oh, you'll hear it. We'll get that.
Many minutes are we now? 4?
We're just over 5 minutes now.
This is a good bit here. Harmony section with the rest of the other instruments. Great. A lot of guitar players. Lead guitar players, let's put it like that. Think solos. Oh, so let's just play along the rhythm section, you know, clash with it so then it stands out. That's what you want. Guitarist listening.
All to you.
All me.
So here we're back on the vocals again. It's sort of just nice and mellow. Oh, Jesus. Lovely backup singing there too. That's about you like air. That's you about there.
That's nice, pizzicato on strings.
Oh, no, that's that man. He's done research for us. For the music theory. So this is where you think the song's going to end now.
Yeah. Drops down.
They're sort of getting up to a big crescendo and then they drop it right down.
Perfect place to end it. Makes sense.
Here's your marching band drumming now.
Come I like this now. Bit though.
That's good. This was always my favourite bit of the song.
This piano session gets me.
The song basically is finished.
This is just an outro.
Because there's no other words. They sing something, but I don't know what the hell they're singing. But,
oh, it's shouting or something.
It's like some sort of fight, no. But they fill it with there's like a bass singer singing right through it, and maybe there's maybe harmonies or something as well. I guess your bass singing there.
Vocals.
Yeah. This is sort of the heavy rock section of it compared to the rest of it.
I suppose it's, well, you gotta put it in context of the album, back when albums were actually a real thing, not just streaming one track at a time.
Yeah.
You wonder what the next track after that is.
Ugh, I didn't even know what it was. That was a heavier one than that was the other ones.
I think it's got to be some kind of a lead in there or something.
Yeah, maybe.
You can't have it all baldy and then just bam, back right in your face again.
Need something in there that bridges the gap, I suppose. Here we go. This is all shredding up now. And I like the sound of the rain as it fades out.
November rain.
I think the video for this song, it starts with him sitting in the bed drinking pills or something while it's raining outside. And I think it ends with him.
Is he in the church?
Slash his solos in the church. The video, if I recall, was he's sitting on the bed popping pills and it's raining outside. I think, and then he does like a flashback where he's getting married or something and she must die.
Mm-hmm.
That's why he's slamming out pills. But they're getting married, Slash walks out of the church and he rips into the big solo when he's standing outside. That's what it was.
In the rain.
No, it wasn't raining when he's doing solo. It was a good dry day.
in the desert.
It was, surely.
It was actually in the desert, like
that. It was just in the middle of nowhere. There's a nice fence around it, though. This wee circle fence, and he's standing right in the middle of it.
I just went out to sand.
That's right, and he's leaning way back. Must be uncomfortable playing your turn to get
can you build many houses out of that sound?
Jesus Christ, you couldn't. That's how the desert sounds. There's no structural integrity
with
it. It's not even too dry, there's no structural integrity with it, don't they? That's what it is. So this is my second pick, you know, it's November Rain. Use Your Illusion 1. Use Your Illusion 2 came out that year as well.
Pretty much same week.
Pretty much, I think, simultaneously.
Aye.
And they both sold pretty well, I think. They both sold more than a million records in America in the same year. Like, not like one did well and then another. They both pretty much did well together.
Well, I suppose saves you waiting 2 years for a double album.
That's true.
May as well just release a double album.
I think they'd want it the next year. I think, was the Appetite for Destruction, did it come out the following year or something, or 93 maybe, or something like that?
I thought November Rain was later, but I wasn't really sure.
No, it was 91, but the likes of, I think, Welcome to the Jungle and that year were possibly the next year or the year after. I can't remember. I looked it up last night when I was doing research, but I can't remember off the top of my head. I didn't write it down.
Not sure with that, am I?
Okay, we'll look into that and let you know.
If he's really stressed about it and losing sleep over getting contact. And
yes, that's it. We're on Facebook, Twitter,
Instagram,
YouTube.
Bandcamp.
Yes, that's Rue Recordings, by the way.
The
podcast, yes, yeah, and that's on what?
Apple, Spotify, Google, and pretty much everything.
Yeah, be sure and add it to your podcast.
And give us a wee review on the Apple podcast. That just brings us up the rankings a wee touch.
Yep, from second last, maybe to like third last. I don't know.
Joint last.
From nothing to joint last. Class. So that's that. That's two each.
We
have one more each. No,
notable mentions. Before we get under
very
our
good
final
actually
track.
Good idea, Anthony. We said we'd discuss the notable albums of the year. Let me see. So we had Nirvana, Nevermind.
Nevermind, classic album.
That was cracker. I mean, that's top school.
It
was a good one.
You know, everybody gets very excited about Smells of Teen Spirit.
Yes.
But
it was a good song now.
It's a good song, but you see the rest of the album. The rest of the album is an absolute masterpiece
it
compared
is.
To.
So I'll stick one on you for you. That's
yep, surely.
Come As You Are.
That is a tune.
Wasn't there was a 20 minute track on Lithium or something?
The very last one. It's
I don't know. I can't remember the name of it. It was like 20 minutes.
All apologies.
Aye. As you are, as you were. Dave Grohl's powerful drumming there. Remember he was a drummer.
Is that the only guy for the first time?
Before he joined the Foo Fighters, he was the drummer for. Nirvana.
Before he started singing and playing guitar, he was actually a drummer.
Oh, that's right.
He's a better drummer than a guitar player. Got thrown out there.
It's just mostly rhythm guitar, isn't it?
He does.
For a few fighters.
Any other noticeable mentions?
Obviously, yeah, we'll turn that off. That's Come As You Are. Let's see what else we had. REM, Out of Time. Just a couple of notable songs there. Now, I'm going to pick a delightful one.
Shiny Happy People, boys.
I hear this the radio every now and again.
Yeah, well, they like the orchestra section, that's a bit.
That's
and
nice.
Then there's a bit in the middle of it as well.
I don't think the orchestra section fits, though.
It's weird because
they do this
just
at the start and then it wraps into the.
Speeds up and then. Bam!
But they break into that orchestra section again doing
they
that
do.
Thing.
They break her down again. That's odd.
I like the song, right, but that doesn't fit for me personally.
Personally, I would have chose Losing My Religion off that album.
Well, honestly, it just happens. I have it in here too. It's a good song too. REM weren't bad, they were a bit mad, aren't they?
They're right
well.
There.
Aye.
But then they were from Georgia. Atlanta, Georgia.
We'll see. We're from Georgia, the country.
Not Georgia, the country, no. They're from Atlanta, Georgia. They weren't from Atlanta, but they were.
They're from state of Georgia.
State of Georgia.
Yes, that makes more sense.
College rockers.
College rockers, there you go.
So that's how they started.
So, yeah, let's lose my religion. What else did we have? We had The Commitments. As I said, we talked about the film earlier on. The
soundtrack for it, phenomenal.
The soundtrack was out that year too. The album came out, so.
There's only one non-musician in that cast.
Singer.
Can you guess?
Singer.
No, the trumpet player.
Aye, the boy playing
the
trumpet there.
The boy that actually is like trying to teach him how to play jazz or soul. He was only trained actor in amongst them.
Aye, he wasn't a musician.
He wasn't a musician.
The rest of them were just singers and musicians. The one doll out of that, she's in Pulp Fiction.
Aye, Brona Geller from Derry.
She's from Derry. She was Pulp Fiction. That was on Last Date, actually.
Aye.
I watched that scene where they have to stab Uma Thurman with the adrenaline in the heart. She's sitting there. Shaking like a leaf.
Part of that new film she's in is supposed to be amazing. The one she's she gets pregnant. She's living in Derry. I can't remember the name of it now.
A new film. Is that the one with Jamie Dornan in it? No.
No, it is actually set in Derry.
I saw that on some of the streaming services. All you wanna do, I can't remember what it's called. I was very surprised to see, because they called it Derry. I was like, ooh, that is.
Let's talk about our song.
Could be, I read the title of it and read that bit of information and thought, not my kind of film. But
quite
I mean,
really
why is it? Because it's in Derry.
Probably really good.
But there's, that's Commandments. They also did a cover of In the Midnight Hour.
It's
not bad now.
That whole album is amazing. I just listened to it on
yes,
the tape.
We would recommend it.
Highly recommend it.
Highly recommend it. Well, most of the albums.
Gets the two thumbs up.
Two thumbs. But most of the albums that you, the ones we're talking about here, are all pretty good. Now they're all worth listening to. That Dolly Parton one that I talked about, that came out, that's didn't do so well, but it's alright. It's alright. What else have we got? Women's R.E.M. Nirvana. Power of Equality, Red Hot Chili Peppers, came out that year. Red Hot Chili Peppers, the early stuff.
Blood Sugar Sex Magik came out that year. Blood Sugar Sex Magik came out that year.
Oh, is that the name of the album? Or the, oh, right. That's the name of the song then. Let me see. Give It Away was in that, wasn't it?
It was.
Bit of a mad song. I like the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
The drumming's class and the bass line's always good in it. And that was whenever they had a proper good guitarist as well. Which is he is now back with the Red Hot Chilis.
Who used to buy the died? He was like a. Was he like. When they started, he was a guitar player or something. See, I don't think he actually. Were they inducted into the Hall of Fame or something, but he wasn't actually an official member or something. He didn't get in or something. I remember reading about it, but I can't remember the details.
He was in the band before they got famous.
Yes.
So that's what Under the Bridge is about.
Yes.
Him dying.
Ah, see.
Which is also on that album.
But he only died recently.
You sure?
I think so. I remember the Lullaby died recently. There was a guitar player from Red Hot Chili Peppers.
He was the in-between guitar player.
Ah. Yes.
John Frusciante was on this album. He wasn't on the next one, but then he was on the next two after that. Three, four after that there, and yeah. Then he went solo, and now he's back again. And now he's sounding good again. Which is good.
So, yeah.
Also, he can't sing live. So, high regards to production value. Your man went to absolute town.
Yes, they're not good singing live.
They're not a live band. They're a studio band.
There you go. They're not bad now, studio.
He has them sounding tight.
So that's them. The last one, and I think you're going to lead into something here as well. I have on my list is Metallica, the Black Album. Do you have some? Aye. You were going to do one then, wasn't it?
I was, and then I changed my mind.
Ah, you were. Well, we'll play it then, anyways.
I wonder what it is.
If you're a Metallica fan, there you go.
It just happened to be a coincidence that Today FM were doing a special in 1981 the other night.
I must have. Rage it. You heard the well,
something. I heard this track, and I heard the Blur track, and that's all I heard.
So Enter Sandman, if anyone doesn't know, that's what we're playing here.
It's a double snare coming in now.
Good old fashioned heavy metal there, but
yeah, early Metallica was pretty good actually.
This is their first album that they're sort of leading away from the thrash metal.
With the DJs on it?
Did they have a DJ? I don't think they did.
No, I wouldn't have thought that either.
But no, but actually the style of it was that thrash metal style, really, really fast and really, not messy, but controlled messy. Then you have this album where most of the songs on it are like proper, a couple of ballady songs on it. But they're all sort of like this here, just regular heavy metal.
What do they say, Lars Ulrich's the worst drummer ever?
You ever see South Park would make fun of download music off the internet? It's like, go to Lars Ulrich's house, like, Lars Ulrich wanted to build a, I don't know, 50 metre fucking swimming pool in his backyard. But because people were downloading his songs, he could only build a 40 metre swimming pool. He's sitting on the bench crying. That was a good episode.
He has no natural timing for a drummer. I think they let him tear away and the Metallica have to play with him.
Aye, they felt sour in him. That's quite funny, actually.
That's true story.
But that's what we got from the Black Album too, because I like this song too. Nothing Else Matters.
That's a good song too.
This is their power ballad.
You want a lot of power ballads? This...
Power ballads are good. Just happened to be the songs I liked from 1981.
Were power ballads?
Boston. The last one actually, I have possibly as a ballad too. But if yours do first. Just listen to a bit more of this. It's a good song.
Nice harmonics.
Yep. It's a nice melody.
It doesn't get any heavier now, it gets a wee bit heavier.
It does a wee bit heavier, there's a solo in the middle, but it's a bit like that Guns N' Roses one, it's a nice, softy sort of solo. It's a wee bit heavier when the rhythm guitar starts on. So
close, that's a heavy drum kit for that song.
Yeah. I have heavy metal drum kit. What do you want?
But as you say, the genre is defined by the amount of drums you have.
I suppose that's probably true enough. Like that simple jazz drum one, you don't really need much snare and a cymbal. It's the sticks that define it. The brush sticks. rock and roll, your single bass, three toms, you can do your right. Heavy metal, pretty sure they have the double bass. Or the two pedals, I know. Iron Man has two basses. And your man for Iron Man has about a million drums. He's class.
Yeah.
Nico McBain, or whatever it's called.
Is he still at it?
They're all still there.
It must be touching 80 now.
What, yes. They've been going since the late 70s, Iron Man. And I think Bruce Dickinson didn't join them until the 80s sometime. I can't remember the singer who was in before that. I can't remember his name.
Changed personnel a lot.
They only changed the singer. Mm. All the guitarists, I think, all stayed the same. I think they introduced one more, the guitarist. I can't remember his name. So they have three guitar players, bass player, singer, drummer. I was a big fan of Iron Man when I was at school.
Sure, you know they look them, so.
They're pretty class. I've watched a video there on YouTube the other day, and there was a woman, she was reviewing or commenting and singing, and she does different songs, but somebody must send her Iron Maiden singing live, Bruce Dickinson, and just crazy, she was loving it. She thought he was unreal, all the stuff he was doing, I don't know, but. And I mean, I showed you on. The fella in New York, the gangster fella, whatever he is.
Oh, I.
Doing the Iron Man song. He fucking loved it.
Lost the head.
Like a pure rapper sort of fella. And he was sitting there, he was jumping up on the seat. He was loving it. Yes, as high it was. That's a good song,
that's
right?
A good song.
Pretty good song to choose, but that was that. So that was Metallica there. That was our notable albums, I know. Metallica, Black Album.
Highly recommend Saw Doctors.
Saw Doctors, right? Ah, yeah, you did that.
This isn't rock and roll. Full album.
Let's go with Saw Doctors. What do you want that night? I used to love her, or that's what she said last night.
N17.
I don't have that enough.
That's what she said.
They accidentally added the full album. And then took all but two songs off.
I prefer this one to I Used to Love Her. You remind me of some. Maybe we're playing with him.
That's right. Well, is it Joyce County Kelly Band or something?
Oh, I hate that Kelly song.
That's the day song. Well, that's right. Right, down the fly one year, me and Anthony. Was that in Tomb, was it?
From Tomb to Tomb.
Tomb to Tomb, that year. We're playing in the Thatch Bar in Tomb. Margaret Radigan. Good woman. dead horse and everything. Next thing you're, what do you call your man? Come in.
Liam Warren.
He came in and everyone was going fucking mad. Like, oh, there he is. Can you sing a song?
I've been here before.
can you sing a song? And they sung
That Choice Country.
Yeah, they sung that. We played away with him and was for a bit. Everyone was loving it. He must have sung for about 10 minutes. It just kept going. Jesus.
It is. I think the way the song's set up, that it can be like a finale of a concert, so we can just keep going on and on and on.
And that's
forever.
What he did. He just kept going for like 10 minutes. I was sitting there thinking, Jesus, where's all the funny?
It's like three chords the whole way through. It's awful.
Because we were looking to a mad and a bigger opportunity again. I wish this man finish.
Man's a big star.
He was a big star.
But then he's from Tume, so.
Well, you were the big star, sat night, didn't
we? We were the big stars.
Everyone was looking to know who are these lads from the north.
Who are these?
They're playing wild good music for a boy from the north. So, any more albums there before we move on?
Why not? I'm too sexy.
Is that your choice? Or
no,
is that,
it's not my choice.
No, that's an album. Or a song. A notable song.
Well, that album came out that year too. The song, can't remember the song.
Too sexy for my love.
Just for giggles. We're still in that era between. We're still trying to live in the 80s, but we're getting into dark 90s music, so.
This came out in 91 as well.
91. Kind of like wrong, to be honest.
My shirt's so sexy, it hurts.
Yeah, it does hurt.
Not only that.
And that's mostly it.
That's
well, before we go on to the last selection each, a few couple of other things happened in the 90s. Eurovision, Euro 91. So we're going to Rome, where the Eurovision took place, and the winner was Sweden. This is controversial, by the way, too. Controversial voting system, or scoring system, or something. France and Sweden actually drew. They went to count back. Sweden and France both had 4-12 scores from whoever went to the tens. Sweden had 5, France had 2, so Sweden were the winners. Singer was Carola Hagfest. That's some pronunciation.
That's you did well.
The song's actually in Swedish. I can't say the Swedish words, so I'll do the English translation. Captured by a Love Storm.
It does sound like a Eurovision title.
Yeah, I'll play it for you. It actually sounds pretty good. Will I find it here? It sounds like something else. I can't put my finger on what song it is.
I know what you're talking about.
What do you call that song? I'm so excited.
That's Pointer Sisters. Like.
Yes. But that's just a wee sneaky preview of it.
Sneaky preview.
We'll make close the show with that, don't we? That's a pretty good song. Ireland's representing that year was Kim Jackson. Could it be that I'm in love? Couldn't find it anywhere, so I don't know what it sounds like. But she didn't win.
Well, I suppose the reign of Eurovision didn't kick off till, was it 92 or 93?
Oh, you didn't ask me. I don't know. Must have been around that time, because
won like 4 in a row.
Father Ted touched on it, mine. Getting too expensive to hold.
Won like 4 in a row, so.
It did. But my last thing for 1991 that I have is the Academy Awards. We'll skip straight to the musical section. Record of the year, unforgettable. Natalie Kinkle and Nat King Cole. Single of the year, unforgettable. It must have been written by Irving Gordon. That's who's credited with that. Album of the year, unforgettable.
Some might say it was unforgettable.
It was an unforgettable song. So here it is, anyways. So we'll put a wee snippet on for you.
Unforgettable. I don't know.
It's not a bad song, though.
That's what you are.
I thought it was older than that.
The original may be older. If he If he sung, this is the duet, you see. Mm. I didn't know when it was written, I didn't look it up. I figured it was 1991, but he could be right there, a couple older than that. So it won 3 awards. Like a song of love. Male vocalist that year, Michael Bolton. Mm. When a Man Loves Woman, that's the cover of When a Man Loves Woman. It's not a bad version.
No.
It's a bit, I think it's a bit slower than the original. Seems very,
a wee touch.
Very, very slow. He does a good job. Sure he does.
Michael Bolton's alright. You're into that.
Mm-hmm.
You're into Michael Bolton, he says. It's alright.
Right. There you go, there's that. Boom.
Which was also in the Commitment soundtrack.
Yes, there you go. So there you go. a female vocalist then was Bonnie Raitt. R-A-I-T-T. Something to talk about. Here it is here. I've never heard of her before, so I don't even know what. Starts off okay, I know. It's nice and clean.
Sounds something else.
Sounds almost like a country song. Like a modern day. People are talking about people. Bit bluesy, something. You won't believe gospel. Oh, mix of stuff.
Yeah, this blues is 12 bar blues.
It's not bad now. So that's that. So that's all my information.
Definitely the big song of the year had to be Bryan Adams.
Bryan Adams, that's right. Which, did I put that in there?
If you didn't know, everyone knows that song.
I don't think I did.
Everyone knows that song.
No, I didn't. Who else had we?
What was the name of it?
Everything I do.
Everything I do.
Do it for
Robin
you.
Robin Hood.
that's a proper pair of balls. The video very dramatic as well.
Aye, it's like 3 or 4 scenes of the Robin Hood.
Aye.
Film.
That's right. That came out that year. That's right. That's why it's so popular. But, Anthony, last choice, 1991.
Last choice, 91. Thought we'd go jazzy.
Jazzy.
Simply Red.
Simply Red.
Something's got me started. There's an absolute tune.
Let me find it.
Oh, you need this one.
Here we go.
There's so much going on. It's ridiculous. Offbeat stuff.
It's offbeat.
Grooving. Percussion.
Sounds groovy already.
You not heard this one before?
I probably have, but just don't list it very often.
I just found this by pure chance.
Are you sure it came in 1991?
Yep.
Because you've already cheated that already.
I double checked it. Faithless since we parted, I truly know that I need you. But anyway, Simply Red. Never Simply Red fan. The man is an absolute king.
Oh yeah, I definitely heard this song.
This is a real bit here now after the chorus. I give it all up. I give it all up for you. I give it all up for you. And then he just goes clean. He just throws everything at it. Goes clean mad. Second half it. Now.
Yeah, it's jazzy.
Jazzy, groovy, funky. Sort of starting a new decade.
It's the double layer bass on there. It's the big one that's sort of punching there. But is there one in the background too?
I think there is, Never. Since we parted.
Just that before you get into the verse again, the sound of something.
There's probably something. He basically hired a full orchestra, essentially. Just throwing directions of all things and sweeps across. And I give it all up for you. Yes, I give it all up for you. Yes, I give it all up for you.
Yes.
That's a really hard piano part to play.
Say so.
It's 3 chords in really quick succession.
Oh. And there's your horn section.
Unless you're an actual piano player.
Guess you tried out there.
Part of a saxo.
It is. It is. I
really love it. It is. It does feel really 80s, doesn't it?
It actually does.
That's probably what all my songs sound like, because this is something red song.
I like that one note.
Held.
It's not even going on a on time or anything, it's like doing some sort of weird off time.
Everything's off beat, everything's syncopated, everything's moving, it's amazing.
That's not even off beat, that's like putting three into four. Till you find a common where it nails.
I love that. Sunday Red is some classics. I was looking at them last night, it's like, oh, that's a tune.
Yes.
I can't remember names from the you could get go mad and do the popular stuff, but you don't want
to
do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I know that, because everyone listens to popular stuff anyways, mostly.
That's my 1991 in year. And
that's pretty good. Yeah, that's pretty good.
We still have a lot of the 90s to go, so that'll be a lot of dark and.
Well,
we're getting into
all the 90s.
We're getting into dance music at that time too.
Well, I suppose that sounds sort of almost like dancing music too. Pretty good.
We're getting into Italo disco at the early 90s. Yes. If you're starting going into that.
Yes. Pretty good.
Okay, your last
quite
choice.
Like well, before we get into the last choice, something I forgot. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, two notable entries, as far as I'm concerned. John Lee Hooker, not really rock and roll, but.
He's blues.
That's what it said on Wikipedia, so. So we'll just stick on the John Lee Hooker one. I'll find him here. Everyone knows this one. Or Boone. If you've seen the Blues Brothers, you know that song. Good fun too. Boom, boom.
Boom. I like the way the bass line.
Yes.
Does the boom, boom, boom.
Boom, 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 boom.
Gonna shoot you right down. Never noticed that before.
That's a clanging song though. That's what it is. So that's boom, boom. And Tina Turner, we'll stick on Tina Turner because.
Can't go wrong, Tina.
Where did I put Tina? Oops. Not Tina.
Ask commitments.
Slap the finger. Where did I put Tina Turner?
Something's got me started.
There she is. Put this one on, because they redid it with that Kygo, but this is the original remastered version of it.
What's love got to do with it?
Yeah.
Tina had a harder life.
She did. She did, surely. I liked her. Her was very sore on her. She still toured until she was like 100 years old. She couldn't sing, so everything was lip synced. And she still danced away and did everything.
She's only stopped in the last couple of years.
She just wasn't fit to sing anymore. She couldn't actually project her voice.
She had an operation on her throat.
Probably, aye.
I was watching that BBC documentary on her one night.
Ah, yes.
She's now living in Switzerland or somewhere. Do you know?
There you go, there's your big chorus line there.
I like the sort of ska guitar in the background.
Yeah. So there's our Tina. There you go, there's Tina. So my last one then, Anthony, to finish us off is just had a lot of trouble trying to find one because I thought I had one. turns out it actually didn't come out in 1981. It was CNC Music Factory, Gonna Make You Sweat. And for anyone that doesn't know what that is, you'll know by the first line. That's it there. So but turns out it must have come out as a single or something 1990, and then it came out on an album
in 1991 along with Thing for Mickey Gloom.
Yes, which was one of your choices.
Which was one of my choices at the start.
But my choice now, I went away, I did a lot of searching for this song because I don't really like most of the songs that were on the charts and that, and I was struggling to find it. I was like sifting through artists on Spotify looking for 91 albums and I couldn't find any, but I can't remember how I found this. I've googled 1991 rock albums or something, and was surprised to find Ozzy Osbourne. Song is Hellraiser. So this song, written by Ozzy Osbourne, Lemmy, on Zakk Wylde, who's actually the guitar player for Ozzy Osbourne, for this song actually as well. That's about all I have on it. The album was No More Tears, which came out in 1991. It's all stuck around. Lemmy also covered this himself in 1992 with Motorhead. And that's pretty good too.
A lot heavier.
It's heavier. We'll play a bit of it too after. I quite like this song. Remember that? I used to listen to it years ago. Didn't realise it was so late.
Mm-hmm.
He did most of his stuff in the 80s and that as well. Ozzy Osbourne was pretty good now.
He was.
People think he's just a mad fella. People don't... I didn't know he was actually a singer till... like, cause you know, the Osbourne's just been TV.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, what the hell do these people do that they're so rich or whatever? And then I found out like
he's
he was
a, singer.
A proper singer.
Heard a bit 80s kid at snare there.
Yeah. Shh.
Phil Collins special.
Yeah. So this one suits Ozzy more. His voice, he's actually got a pretty good voice, to tell you the truth.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't know, he can barely speak. I think that's down to a lot of other things.
I'll say nothing.
Years of wear and tear. Remember he almost died that time, he fucking crashed the quad or something.
Aye.
He nearly was killed.
The buggy rolled over.
Aye. I think he's Parkinson's now too, which doesn't help him out either.
A lot of those hands there. Bad ways.
He don't really survive long, as long as they have now after the carry-ons he was at. Lemmy too. Like, he only died a few years ago. And like he
was soaring himself.
Holy Jesus. He was soaring himself. Drugs and drink and going at it hard. Say the least. He couldn't survive. Like, he, I remember watching the documentary on him. He finished his days in America somewhere, Los Angeles, in a bar, sat in the same seat every day, and drank Jack Daniels and Coke, and played on the fucking slot machine or something beside him. That's how he finished his days. The place he lived in was like, you wouldn't think he had any money at all. He was like, he was sitting in a room full to the brim with shite that he didn't want to throw out.
Just a big hoarder.
That's exactly what it was, but it's like memorabilia and stuff, and weren't so much antiques. He collected a lot of Nazi paraphernalia as well.
Well, they're worth money now.
Not because he liked the Germans or was supporting Nazis, just because he thought they looked cool.
They're worth a bit of money now.
Probably. I don't know where they're at, because he's dead. I don't know if his son got them or what happened to them. But we're talking right over this, aren't we? Well, that's the wee bit of it. This is...
Seems to be a breakdown section for
the
last
course. Yeah, solo here now for a bit. And then she drops off again. Drops off into the last verse. They still do seem sturdy in nearly. I like the bass there, it's just nice one note basically just played over.
Sounds like something else.
I know what you mean. But I can't put my finger on what it actually sounds like.
Poison?
A wee bit, I know what you mean. That's it.
That glam rock kind of vibe.
Yeah, wee bit. The last three singles is just as instrument. So we'll skip to Motorhead's version. See, it's a wee bit heavier. I actually prefer this one to Ozzy.
But it doesn't count
91. I know, 92. I think the rhythms are almost exactly the same. I think the solo's a wee bit different and the ending's a wee bit different.
I like the bass in this one, more distortion.
Lemmy loved the distortion. He turned her up fucking full blast and turned the volume up full blast. He was mad, hey.
Love distortion.
Plus he has the husky old voice there to suit that as well. Well, man.
Yeah, I like this version better.
Motorhead were pretty good now. They were sort of on the cusp of thrash metal meets heavy metal meets whatever. Ace of Spades is some song.
He was Welsh, wasn't he?
He was Welsh, shy. Lemmy Kilmister or something he's called. Not a very Welsh name right now. But
probably like, they're saying you come down from the hills, there's too sharp down there.
So that's Lemmy's version. Well, not do too much of it, listen to the song once, I suppose, so I don't really do it. So that was my third selection there, Hellraiser. From the album No More Tears for Ozzy Osbourne. The Motorhead album was, I can't remember. I didn't read it down either, so look for it.
It's 1982.
It was 92, yeah.
It's Motorhead.
Yeah. So that's that, Anthony.
That's that.
We're going directly through the end of the day.
1981 was.
It wasn't a bad year.
Wasn't a bad year in the end up.
Yeah, some good tracks come on there. And that's it. Some notable events happened, as I say, we went through them all there.
A lot of things happened.
The music was pretty good. Crack wasn't too bad. So that's us. So that'll about wrap us up then.
That's about wraps it up. Thanks very much for listening.
Yeah. Thanks for listening, alright.
If you have any questions, get in contact with us. As I said, we're on all the socials. And
yep, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube.
Spread the word.
Even if you just want to see us liked it. Or
aye, just send a wee message or something. Aye. Just aye, anything at all. Just
shout out to the Close Brothers.
Close Brothers.
Send me down little chaps not there during the week saying they like the last one. So, so hopefully you like us one too, boys. And we'll go again next week, maybe, Anthony.
Aye, no, probably every fortnight.
Aye, well, that's what I meant, aye.
We'll just keep going until we're tired of stop.
Aye. Again, if you want anything covered, any particular songs or
get in contact
artists or years or whatever you want, let us know.
No problem there.
Well, it's uncovered.
Thanks a million, everybody.
All right.
See you and take care of yourselves. Mm-hmm. And see you in the long grass.
We're going to sign off then with Carola Hagfist and the Swedish Eurovision entry 1981. Winner 1981. Which was called
Always Go Out With The Winner.
Captured by Love Storm.